China and the United States holding nuclear talks next week, the first since the Obama administration. According to a report by the Wall Street Journal, China's foreign ministry said the two countries would hold consultations on arms control and non-proliferation, as well as separate talks on maritime affairs and other issues. This comes after the visit of Foreign Minister Wang Yi to Washington. The Pentagon believes China has more than 500 operational nuclear warheads in its arsenal and will probably have over 1,000 warheads by 2030. But Beijing has long argued that the U.S. already has a much larger arsenal. The United Nations Refugee Agency warns Pakistan its expulsion of more than a million undocumented immigrants risks triggering a human rights catastrophe. Pakistan has said it will expel undocumented foreign nationals beginning November 1st, citing security reasons. This includes hundreds of thousands of Afghans who have fled their home country to escape the Taliban rule. The expulsions come despite calls to reconsider from the UN rights groups and other Western embassies.
As you know, that Afghanistan is going through a severe humanitarian challenges, including human rights challenges for women and girls. And the government of Pakistan is implementing this plan, and we believe that such plans will have serious implications for all those who have been displaced and who may face serious protection risk upon their return. So we are asking, we are appealing the government to come up with a comprehensive, sustainable mechanism to manage and register all these people who need international protection in Pakistan.
Pope Francis is attending the COP28 climate conference in Dubai next month. This is the first time a pontiff will attend the UN meeting since it began in 1995. Now, the Pope told Italian state media that he will be in Dubai from December 1st to the 3rd. There, he is expected to drive home his appeal for action to curb global warming. The 86-year-old leader of the Catholic Church has made environmental protection one of the hallmarks of his papacy. In a major document released in October, the Pope appealed to climate change deniers and foot-dragging politicians to have a change of heart with the future of the world at stake. The U.S. Federal Reserve leaves interest rates unchanged for a second straight time in a widely expected move. The Fed agreed to keep its benchmark rate at about 5.4%. Now, it's the highest level in 22 years, but it maintained a hawkish stance on further rate hikes should inflation pressures accelerate. Fed Chairman Jerome Powell cites the expanding U.S. economy for their decision, but he admits the process of getting inflation sustainably down to their 2% target has a long
in December. We haven't made that decision. I would say, though, that the idea that if you the idea that you would be difficult to raise again after stopping for a meeting or two is just not right. I mean, the committee will always do what it thinks is appropriate at the time. And again, we haven't made any decisions about December. We didn't talk about making a decision in December today.
U.S. trade representatives heading to San Francisco this month for the APEC summit as it turns to more Asian nations for investments in its booming manufacturing sector. This report.
From semiconductor plants in Arizona, Ohio, and New York, to solar panel makers in Georgia, to windmill production in Colorado, manufacturing is coming back to U.S. soil.
Yeah, well, we are in what we call a manufacturing supercycle.
Rosemary Coates is the executive director of the Reshoring Institute, a nonprofit that supports manufacturing in the United States.
Well, industrial real estate investment is up by 30% this year. I've talked to a couple of developers and actually spoke at a big conference last week where the industrial development community is all excited.
The recipe for this super cycle, say trade experts, is the combination of billions of dollars in manufacturing incentives under the Biden administration, coupled with tariffs and trade restrictions imposed by the Trump administration. Jamison Greer served as chief of staff under U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer.
We have to recognize that the Trump administration passed a new NAFTA that incentivized more production in the United States, and they imposed tariffs on China that disincentivized imports of auto parts and autos from China.
So far, President Joe Biden has kept former President Donald Trump's tariffs on Chinese goods and his ban of U.S. technology exports to Chinese companies like Huawei. Both administrations supported a combination of subsidies and trade restrictions designed to protect American workers and innovation, as U.S. Trade Representative Katherine Tai explained at the Center for American Progress in October.
So whether that's through supply chains, through coordinating defenses against unfair policies, we are looking for better ways of acknowledging the challenges that we have encountered.
Greer says this new American trade posture is evident in the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, or IPEF, which is being negotiated between APEC nations. Unlike the comprehensive trade agreements of the past, IPEF, he says, increases trade through targeted and incremental steps.
I think that we do have a new approach now. And I think, you know, what I hope is not, it's not an anti-trade approach. And again, it's not a protectionist approach, but it's a pragmatic approach.
Coates says it's also an approach that fits the strategic priorities of modern American companies, one of choosing to produce goods closer to the buyer so they can reduce emissions.
When you shorten global supply chains, you also reduce your carbon footprint.
This, says Coates, is the new face of Made in America. Jessica Stone, VOA News.
Philippine lawmakers betting on the upcoming visit of Japan's top leader in Manila to open more economic opportunities. Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida is making a two-day official visit to the country beginning Friday, that's tomorrow. He will hold talks with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on a range of issues, including security and economic cooperation. The Japanese leader is also set to address a special joint session of Congress. That's on November 4, Saturday. House Speaker Martin Romualdez says he is bullish the visit will open doors for more opportunities for Filipinos here and in Japan. Marcos brought home about $13 billion worth of investment pledges during his trip to Japan last February. A Filipino educator says teaching the Filipino language in the prestigious Harvard University is her way of giving back to her home country. Don Tagala tells us more about Lady Eileen Orsal, Harvard's first Tagalog instructor.
Now that Tagalog is the fourth most common language spoken at home in the U.S., this Filipina is helping even more people to learn how to speak it in America.
Ako po si Lady Eileen, ang inyong lingkod, at marami pong salamat sa bawat isang nandito.
Lady Eileen Orsal even made history by becoming the first ever Filipino language instructor at Harvard University in Cambridge, Massachusetts. It was also the first time that such an academic program was offered at the Ivy League University, with a Filipino educator hired to do just that.
So doon pa lang po masaya na ako. Sabi ko nga po kahit nung interview sinabi ko na kahit sino matanggap, masaya ang buong Filipino community, Filipino-American community na i-offer ito for the first time. So nung ako po yung natanggap, syempre po masaya, pero sobrang nanginginig kasi kinakabahan kung kaya ko ba.
With 1.76 million speakers, Tagalog is the fourth most common language spoken in the U.S. according to the U.S. Census Bureau. Orsal says she teaches two Filipino language classes, elementary and intermediate Filipino, for Filipino-Americans and for non-Filipinos as well.
Karamihan po sa mga estudyante ay gusto pong matuto ng wika para po hindi lang para makapag-usap sa mga kamag-anak, kundi gusto rin nilang matuto ng higit pa tungkol sa kultura sa Pilipinas. At marami din po sa kanila ay nagsasagawa ng pananaliksik. So sana makatulong yung pag-aaral ng wika para mas maintindihan nila yung mga binabasa nila.
Orsal is no stranger to teaching Tagalog in America. She spent 9 months on a Fulbright Foreign Language Teaching Assistant program at the Northern Illinois University. It's a non-degree program for early career English teachers to refine their skills through exposure to U.S., sponsored by the U.S. State Department. She's also getting her Master of Arts degree in Communication Studies at the Northern Illinois University while finishing her doctorate in Philippine Studies at the De La Salle University in Manila. Orsal's dissertation is a study on the impact of integrating culture in teaching Filipino in America, which perfectly aligns with her teaching style at Harvard. The educator considers this as a way of giving back to the Philippines by promoting Filipino language and culture in America.
bilang isang ate, kuya, sa komunidad, yung mga magulang, na pa palagi natin pwedeng ipasa. So patuloy po natin na i-promote yung ating kultura, ating wika, at yung diversity. At syempre po, yung mag-aisa lang tayo na palaging gawin ito para sa bayan.
Orsal's initial contract with Harvard is 3 years, but may be extended depending on how the program goes. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, Cambridge, Massachusetts.